Rucha S. Khot here from Flora Language Solutions. Welcome. Herzlich willkommen. You can know more about me on ruchaflora.com. So before beginning today's video and going ahead into the nitty-gritties, etc., I want to ask all of you if you have ever had such instances while learning German, not after you have learned German, but you know, when you are in the process of learning German, that you tend to use some English words. So there is also one dialect, by the way, which is not an official dialect, called Denglish, which is a mixture of Deutsch and English. So Deutsch, German and English. So it's called Denglish, like, you know, we have the Hindi and English versions of English and many other things like that. So any language combined with English takes its own form. So there is a form that is quite famous around in Germany also, which is Denglish, where you use German and English together, but it is not the official language and it is used just for fun among students and the youth of Germany. But seriously, when I was learning German, I did have at least 4 to 5 such instances where unknowingly, instead of speaking the English word, I was speaking out the German word. And you know, that tends to happen when you know the language, or when you're in touch with the language or studying the language probably for more than 2 or 3 hours a day. And there was such time in my life. So you know, today I'm going to be discussing with you what are those instances where, you know, you tend to confuse English and German, and what are the instances and situations when you are prominently going to use some German words in your English conversations, or even if you're conversing normally in your mother tongue, you might just use a German phrase. Now, I just want to give you an example. So at home, my mother tongue is Marathi. I speak in Marathi with my parents and with my maternal family. So when I was learning German, obviously I was not married. And you know, sometimes I used to just go to my mother and say, Mama, ich habe Hunger, or I ich habe Hunger. I is the, I is mother in Marathi. And so I used to be like, I ich habe Hunger. And I didn't realize that I'm actually just, you know, popping out the German phrase. And my mom used to be like, hey, what are you saying? Just wait. And then I used to be like, oh, I'm sorry, I'm just hungry, just give me some food. So, you know, we did have such kind of conversations, and this is just one such incident. So there are going to be many such instances, like at least 8 to 10 of them, which are very common. So in today's video, we are going to be covering that, about how you can just know those instances so that when you're speaking, you are more aware of what mistakes you're about to make, and then you can avoid from making them happen when you're talking in German, or even when you're talking in English. You can make sure that you don't use the German terms when you're talking in English. So it's not a rocket science as such, but yes, learning any other language does have the chances of creeping in into your English language. Now, before going ahead in today's video, I just want to request you to please subscribe to my channel if you have not, and do hit the notification bell so that you keep getting future updates. So without much ado, let's begin today's video. First instance that I want to talk about, where you tend to use like German words in your English and maybe the other way around sometimes, is the word Oder. So Oder means or in German. You know, sometimes the weather is not good, so we might just tend to say in English, terrible weather, right? And things like that. So there's someone besides me, terrible weather today, right? So instead of saying that, if I know German, I might just tend to say, terrible weather, Oder. And that person will be like, hey, Oder, what's Oder? So Oder is basically or in German. Terrible weather, or what do you think? You know, it's that kind of a way of saying Oder. So Oder as a conjunction means or, but Oder is also, you know, like a word where you seek conversation, or where you seek, you know, someone's agreement to something. Like you say, right na, in English, or in Hindi also you tend to say, kya lag raha hai aapko na? You know, that kind. So Oder is also used in such context. So please be careful. So it's not like, you know, when you want to say right, you can't change it with Oder. But if such instances do happen, then do keep in mind that your German mind is more active than your English mind. next thing where you tend to use the German part into the English language is mostly with the numbers. So in German the numbers are said the other way around. Like for example, if I'm saying 23, I don't say like for 2 and 3, then I don't say 23, I say 23. So in English, so you have that in your mind. Okay, 23, 24, 25, and so on. So 23, 24, and 25. And then when I'm saying those numbers in English, I might just tend to say that, oh, so it's like 52, right? Like, and you'll be like, so 52. So you might actually be thinking 25, but you're saying 52 because of the German way that you've got used to saying it. So this happens a lot, and trust me, I'm not joking. Initially, when you are so much immersed into memorizing the numbers and things like that, there might be a chance when you do say something like that. So it's basically like so when you say 21, so 21 is 2 and 1, so 1 and 20, that is how it's said in German. Ein und zwanzig, but the ein comes before the 20. So how much is it? 1 and 20. The shopkeeper probably who's learning German, when you're buying potatoes or something, the potatoes are for 21 rupees per kg. And so in a normal situation, the shopkeeper in Germany, probably who's an immigrant, might just tend to say 1 and 20. And then you should realize, no, so he actually means ein und zwanzig, and he's thinking that way. So this might come across as dumb, but trust me, I'm sure for the beginners and the intermediate learners out there, at least 30% of the people will have had this instance where they are, so tuned to saying the German numbers in the way they are, like the opposite way around, that they tend to say their English numbers also in the same way. So be careful. Thirdly, many of the people confuse their V's and F's. So, when you're learning German, you know that the V and the F sound is mostly the same. So, V is Fau and F is F. So, but all the sentences all the words that, begin with a V are usually pronounced with a F. So, von, yeah, V-O-N. It's not von, it's von. So that comes to English also. Sometimes, for example, a thing like a vase, V-A-S-E, vase, you might just tend to say faz, or something like a pheasant, yeah, you might just tend to say pheasant. So, there are many such instances that can come across with the V and the F. So you have to be careful next with your V and F. One more instance like this, the fourth one that I would like to suggest are the J's and the Y's. So J in German is pronounced like a Y. So for example, if your name is John, you might tend to say Yon. Yon, not that Yon. J-O-H-N will be Yon because it's John and then J is pronounced. So if someone's name is John, you might just tend to say, oh Yon, come here. So, you should be careful like that. And this does happen a lot. Now, I'm sure this is not uncommon for many. It didn't happen with me. It did happen with me. So, we tend to say, yeah, that way. So, sometimes I just used to, in English, I used to say, ja. So, ja, as in, I meant ja in German, but the other people thought ja. So, ja is like, in Hindi, ja means to go away. So, yeah. Such things happen. So J and the Y's are confused. So there also, when you're talking and when you're unknowingly just immersing yourself in the language, just try and be careful with the J's and Y's, even when you're talking in your English language or other mother tongues. This instance is with the word super. Now super is S-U-P-E-R, super in English. Now in English, super means when something is great, and you don't use it very frequently. It's only when somebody has performed really well, you say, oh super. Or if the food is great, you might just say, oh this food is super, and things like that. So it is something where you praise something. But the Germans tend to use super even when they've had a good time. So I don't say I've had a super good time. So I don't think we use super that much in English. But if the Germans have had a good time at a party or an occasion, they might just tend to say super. Or if they've had a good holiday, they might describe that holiday as super. Or if in the university someone's lecture was really good, and if someone asks how was the lecture, lecture, then you might also get a reply as super, or when somebody is speaking something really nicely and they tend to get impressed with the way they are speaking, they might tend to say super, and many such instances. Even the barbecue can be described as super in German. So how is the barbecue? Super. That's how, you know, a few Germans might tend to say. So it's a very commonly used word in German, which we don't do it in English. So please be careful while using super in the English language. You cannot say that I had a super good time somewhere. So grammatically it sounds correct, but I don't think it's actually the correct way of saying that I had a good time somewhere. So super in English has a slightly different context than in German. So that's one place where you guys need to be careful. So the next instance, the sixth instance, so this happens a lot with me, not now, but it did happen with me. So, you know, you tend to use filler words as German. For example, now if you're an intermediate German learner, you're pretty much aware of the vocabulary related to food and nature and, you know, all the food items or the restaurant items or the dish items in German. You even know what's a fork and a knife and a spoon called in German. So there might be an instance when, you know, instead of saying, could you please pass me the fork and knife, you might just say, could you please pass me the Gabel and Messer. Gabel and Messer is fork and knife. So this happened with me, and this also happens with many people who learn German, say for the second level or the third level, and then go to Germany, and it's a formal occasion. You might just tend to use, could you please pass me the Gabel and Messer, instead of could you please pass me the fork and knife. So this tends to happen with words that go together, like, you know, a fish and fishbowl, or a door and a lock and key and things like that, or a bat and ball. So usually pairing words. So be careful when you're learning the pairing words, because usually for pairing words, you know, we remember it together. And when you learn it in some other language, there is a chance that, you know, instead of using the English version of it, you might use the another language version that you're using. So in my case, since I was learning German, for fork and knife, I used Gabel and Messer. But the same can be for bat and ball, lock and key, etc. You might tend to use the German version of it. So, you know, you should be very reminiscent and careful when you're learning the pairing words, that while speaking out those words in English, you should always try and use the English version of it. So probably this video might seem, you know, coming out of a bit out of my own experiences too, but trust me, I spoke to a few of my students as well who've had these experiences, and I got good responses from them that yes, these mistakes have happened, or not mistakes as such, but, you know, these slip of tongue things have happened with them too. So don't take it lightly, and this is definitely not dumb if you're doing it. It's just a process of you learning the language. So just don't be ashamed of it and go with the flow. So there is no best for last or anything like that in today's video, because this video is just about, you know, something where you can improve yourself. So there is no best mistake or, you know, the worst mistake, etc. But definitely this one that I'm going to talk about is one of the most common ones. So now this time I would say I didn't keep the best for the last, I kept the most common one for the last. So basically the IE and the EI, there is a lot of confusion among the beginners who learn German about how to pronounce the IE and EI, and then when they tend to write the English spellings which have IE and EI, they tend to get super confused. Super, you remember? Okay, so they tend to get really confused. Now see, in German you have words like arbeiten, so arbeiten, EI. In German, EI is pronounced as I and IE is pronounced as E. Unlike in English where, you know, you might just tend to pronounce both as E. For example, receive, R-E-C-I-V-E, not I-E-V-E. So R-E-C-E-I-V-E, receive. So it's not receive, it's receive. So when you tend to say receive in English, you might tend to say receive, because arbeiten, so receive, arbeiten, E-I-I, I-E-E. So please remember this, that in German, the way E-I-N-I-E is pronounced is different, and if English E-I-N-I-E is pronounced is different. Don't tend to confuse both. But because this is the most common one, I would suggest that, you know, you make a list of words, common words which you know, make a list EI words, IE words, and then, you know, when once you have at least 100 words of EI and IE, then just say those words every day for 10 days in German, not in English, and then you will know the difference of EI and IE in German, and then trust me, once you are perfect with the German way of saying it, you won't make the mistakes in English. This worked for me and 6 to 7 of my students. That is why I'm suggesting the way. I hope this works out for you and well. That was all on my side today. I hope you liked today's video. Please do consider subscribing to my channel and try watching videos till the end so that you take a lot out of the videos. So the content that I try to provide is not usually the learning content that everyone is providing, but these are things which are really necessary to know the nitty-gritties of the language, and I try to focus on them. Sometimes I might feel a bit nervous in front of the camera, because even I am in the process of learning YouTube, and I've recently got some new equipments, the mirror light and things like that, and also upgraded my the camera that I'm using, so to bring you a user-rich experience. So I hope these things are working out. Keep liking my work, and if you have anything that you want to share with me, any feedback, please do let me know in the comments below, or you can mail me on floralanguagesolutions@gmail.com. See you in the next one. Tschüss, auf Wiedersehen.